explain to me how there's a sequel when there was never, what was the first one?
The Modern Rogue is not vulnerable to sequel injections.
Most Modern Rogue episodes, I feel like I at least have a toehold on what's going on. This, I am totally out of my depth. I need to rely on a programmer like you, Jason, or UT's very own Jgor. Thank you so much, hacker extraordinaire.
So sequel is used everywhere, right? That is the most common database management application. Anytime you have to enter information or retrieve information using a website, it's interacting with SQL.
So every time you're typing something in an open box, odds are this is SQL structure in the back end. And you're saying there's a flaw in SQL, full stop.
SQL injections are the most common type of hack. They are used everywhere. You can see them hacking the United States government, stealing credit cards from online vendors. In fact, any hack or data breach that you can think of in the last 10 years, most of them are gonna be from SQL injections. Explain to us just the general concept of how it works.
Sure, so SQL, or structured query language, is just a way of querying a backend database and pulling out just the information that you want. So it's kind of like a programming language. You're defining a string of commands, and it knows what to do with those commands in order to retrieve what you wanted. Problem is, some of this is commands and some of this is data.
So like the data would be when I type in, my name is Brian Brushwood, and the commands are, you know, I don't know, like load this website or whatever, right?
Yeah, so Brian Brushwood is the data, but that's put right in the same string as all of these command sequences.
Wait, so the system doesn't know whether it's listening to a command or the data. So if my name was Brian, go to line 20, repeat this command, do X, Y, Z, the other thing. And then when it reads it, it does it.
Essentially, that's exactly it. Yeah, we're telling the backend system to execute exactly what we want after our data.
Now, this vulnerability is really widespread, but it's also exceptionally easy to protect against.
Okay, this is the part I don't understand. If it's so easy to protect against it, why isn't everybody insulated?
Well, you do have to learn a little bit about how the mitigation strategies you're supposed to use, and some people just aren't willing to put in that extra step of effort to learn how to do it the right way.
Most people don't invest in their IT security until it's too late.
Got it. So they're just like, the thing works, I'm not worried about it, I don't see any problems, just keep on running it like it is.
It's never a problem until it's a problem.
Okay, legally, we have to be very, very clear that the very act of attempting a SQL injection is, to the best of our knowledge, we are not lawyers, but the very act of attempting any of this is a felony, correct?
Yes. Again, not lawyers, but don't do it.
Yes, okay, but what might one look like?
So say we have a login page. You got your username and your password. If they're not protecting against that separation from the command and the data, our username, the data, we put a tick and suddenly everything after that becomes commands. So we just say, all right, stop checking here. Let's not check the password.
Wait a minute. Are you telling me there's fully functional websites out there where all you have to do is add a tick mark and then at that point you're executing code on their website? What percentage of websites are vulnerable to this?
A lot.
We could Google something right now and I could almost guarantee you that something in one of those results would be vulnerable.
Well, that's very tempting. However, I know that would be a felony to test, and so we're not gonna do that. What's it like to actually do a SQL injection?
So for example, if we go to, let's say, demo.testfire.net, this is a security tool that's set up specifically so you can test either your security tools or your security knowledge and understand how the attacks work. Altoro Mutual, it's a fake credit union or bank of some sort. We've got all the typical functionality of a bank.
So wait, this is a website that's not an actual bank that I assume has actual accounts that nobody ever uses to check bank accounts that don't exist, but this is all here just for you to try to penetrate.
Exactly.
Okay, all right, go on.
So we have this sign-in functionality here at the top, and I happen to know one of the test accounts. Jay Smith has an account at Altoro Mutual, and his password is demo1234.
Okay.
So we can log in, we see that we have our checking account here, got our savings account. I'm gonna sign out, and we're gonna try signing in again. This time, let's say all we know is he's a username. We know JSmith has an account on this bank. It's going to get mad at us if we don't fill in the password field, so I'm just gonna type a bunch of random characters here. But it doesn't matter, because up here in the username, we're gonna put tick.
And when you say tick, that's the single quote.
Yeah, and at this point, we have ended the user input, the data, JSmith, and now we're gonna start tacking on our own SQL commands. Now we could get as complicated as we want here, but the simplest one is just to put a SQL comment character, which is dash, dash, and then usually a space at the end. What that does is it comments out everything else in this command sequence after the username. One of the things that comes after the username is this password check.
Okay. So if I understand this correctly, it's running code and it gets as far as like enter username, it sees the username, then by putting the dash dash, it assumes whatever is next is a comment. Unfortunately, the next text is also make sure to check for a password.
You got it.
And so that becomes a comment and it does not run that part.
Exactly.
And so does it work here?
Give it a shot.
That's deeply disturbing.
Yeah. Now imagine that you can take these SQL commands and just do whatever you wanted to this site's database.
I would assume in order to do anything of value, you would have to understand the current layout, the structure, the things that this is most likely to do so that you punch in commands that will actually be meaningful, right?
Now, if we were doing that by hand, yes. We would have to, first of all, traverse through all the database names, table names, column names, and figure out exactly what we would want to pull out from the database. But this has been around so long and it's been so polished and perfected that there are tools that'll do all of this work for us. All we have to do is know that this page is vulnerable. We point a tool at it and it will pull out every single piece of data from that database.
Wow. Okay.
Including credit card numbers.
No, hold on. How does it do it? Does it just keep on running like random code to see what it gets back or?
It first of all identifies the vulnerable behavior. It knows what to look for. For example, you put a tick in there and suddenly the page contents change maybe. And we put a tick or 1=1 and now the page has gone back to its legitimate content because 1=1 is always true. So once it confirms that vulnerable behavior, it knows certain strings to inject in there to say, okay, now give me all of the list of databases names, all the list of table names, all the list of column names. Here's a nice pretty list of them.
Wow.
And one of the things that they do is they will intentionally throw up errors in that they'll enter some information and SQL will come back and say, this bit of data is incorrect. Well, now you've told me what that bit of data is.
Right. So if this is such a widespread known vulnerability, what is being done about it? Like, are there best practices that are being propagated or is there some kind of new backend that's in the works? Or is this just like whoopsie doodle, everybody should be better about locking their doors?
So we do know how to address this. Best practice state that you should use prepared statements or parameterized queries that specifically identify, okay, this is our command structure, this piece is data, so never treat it as part of the command. It's just developers have not taken the time yet to follow these best practices. They just naively put everything in one string and say, okay, go ahead and evaluate this one.
So it's not like this is gonna fix itself in the next 20 minutes. If you're making a website, you need to make sure that you are actively going out and finding out what best practices are to make sure you're not subject to one of these. And likewise, anytime you are using a service, you need to ask them, what are you doing to protect against a SQL injection?
Yes, this is very much training on the side of the developer. They need to understand the risks and then know the proper way to do it.
What's funny is that when this was discovered, it was like the mid to late 90s, and it was first written about in a zine called Phrack. And when it was brought to Microsoft's attention, Microsoft is the developer of SQL, Microsoft denied it for 15 years. And the problem itself hasn't changed. And it's still around and it's still very widespread. So be careful about what information you put out there.
Yeah, no, also get out of my house. Filthy hackers, all of you. I don't trust any of you. I'm not comfortable with any of this. Go.
Okay.
I don't like it.